Al with us today, and he's going to speak about JD6 in random geometry.
Well, thank you, Christina. It's a pleasure to be speaking in this seminar. And so I want to speak about geodesics in random geometry. And so I'm going to spend some time, maybe half of the lecture, explaining the models of random geometry I'm considering. So I apologize to those of you who already heard me talk about that, but I think it's important to recall the basics. So, okay, it is. So the starting point is to define a kind of canonical random geometry in two dimensions. And to do that, we will work on the sphere, the two-dimensional sphere, S2. And we replace the sphere by a graph, discrete graph. So we consider what I call a planar map, just simply a graph drawn on the sphere. And we are going to choose this graph in a certain class, say, for instance, a class of all triangulations of the sphere. And more importantly, we are going to look at this object as a metric space. We consider the set of all vertices. We equip it with a graph distance. And then the idea is to take a very large graph, a very large planar map, so to let the size tend to infinity, and to pass to the limit on the corresponding metric space after a certain rescaling, in fact, of the distance. And in the limit, we get a random metric space, which is what I call the Brownian sphere. It's also called very often the Brownian map. It is the same object. Okay. And the nice feature of this construction is that the limit is the same independently of the class of planar maps you start from. Okay. So you really have a universality property for this Brownian sphere. It's a little bit like Brownian motion. It's a kind of universal object, but you can approximate it by many different random walks. Okay, so it's here the same phenomenon. Okay, so in this lecture, I will emphasize the study of geodesics. And I mentioned two recent papers, one of mine and a previous paper of Miller and Kian. Okay, so let me start with the beginning. So I repeat the definition of a planar map. It's simply an embedding of a finite connected graph into the sphere. I said the embedding is proper, meaning just that the edges do not cross. And something which is very important is that I look only at the shape of the embedding. So I identify two such embeddings if they correspond via an homomorphism of the sphere, I should say, an orientation preserving homomorphism. And also I look really at multigraphs, meaning that I allow loops and multiple edges, okay? Mm-hmm. So here is an example, if you want, of the planar map. You should think of it as drawn on the sphere, in fact, not in the plane as on my slide. Mm-hmm. And of course you have in red points here, which are the vertices, and you have edges. Mm-hmm. And something you can define because your graph is embedded, you can define faces, which are simply the connected components of the complement of edges. So the regions of the sphere, which are bounded by edges, okay? And you speak of a P angulation if each face is incident to P edges. When P equals 3, you say it's a triangulation. When P equals 4, it's a quadrangulation. Okay, so there is a subtlety here, which is when you count the number of edges incident to a face. For instance, if you look at this face here, you have this edge here, such that the two sides of this edge are incident to the same face. So you have to count it twice in the degree of the face, okay? So if you want, this face here is the triangle, like in fact, all the other faces where two edges have been glued together. So this planar map represented here is in fact a triangulation, and you can count how many faces you have. 20 faces. Okay. Mm-hmm. And another technical point, which is that you deal with rooted map, meaning that you distinguish one edge, and this edge is oriented. So the other edges are not oriented, but the root edge will be oriented. So for instance, it can be this one oriented in this manner. And the root vertex, by definition, is the origin of this root edge. Okay. So of course, when you do the identification modulo the orientation preserving homomorphisms, you require that you preserve also the root edges. Okay, so just to give you Well, this is just to insist on the fact that you identify modulo homeomorphisms. These are the same two examples of the same planar map. You can go from this one to this one by deforming the edges and moving the vertices a little bit. But on the other hand, these two are different planar maps, although the graph structure, if you look only at the graph structure, is the same, but they are different planar maps because, for instance, this one has a face of degree 6 here. This face here has degree 6, but this one here has no face of degree 6. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so here is an example of a large triangulation of the sphere, which of course is not drawn on the sphere. You know, it's drawn in space by Mathematica. It's drawn in such a way that, let's say, the all edges have approximately the same length. But you can already see that if you take such a typical triangulation of the sphere, you have a kind of fractal structure. Okay. This is what you expect when you take a typical large planar map. Okay, so as I said before, we are going to view planar maps as metric spaces. So let me explain this on this slide. So if you have a planar map M, you can look at the set of vertices of M, V of M. You can equip it with a graph distance. And so you get a metric space, which is of course a simple metric space. It's a finite metric space. But now the idea, of course, is to let the size of the planar map tend to infinity. And to do that, okay, I'll introduce some more notation. I'm going to fix an integer p at least equal to 3. I'm going to look at the set of all p angulations with n faces. Okay, so p is going to be fixed, but n will correspond to the size of the p angulation, and I will later let n tend to infinity. Now, well, for the moment, if n is fixed, this set M and P is a fixed, is a finite set, because you can easily see that you have only a finite number of possible shapes for your P angulation. Mm-hmm. And so you can make sense to choose this capital Mn uniformly at random in this set M and P. Okay, you pick a P angulation with n faces uniformly at random. But now you want to let n tend to infinity. And you are going to look at the associated metric space. It's going to be now a random metric space because Mn is random. So Vm of Mn equipped with the graph distance. And you want to pass to the limit in the space of all compact metric spaces. Well, later we'll see what to do that we need to renormalize the graph distance. But for the moment, you can say that you view this object as a random element, a random variable of this space capital K, K, the set of all compact metric spaces modulo isometries. And in fact, there is a nice way of defining the convergence of a sequence of elements of capital K, which is using the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. Okay, so this slide is just a brief reminder of the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. So first, I remind you of the classical Hausdorff distance between compact subsets of a metric space. And now, if you have two general compact metric spaces, E1 and E2, what you can do to evaluate a kind of distance between E1 and E2 is to embed E1 and E2 simultaneously in the same big metric space capital E. So you look at all isometric embeddings psi1 and psi2 of E1 and E2 into capital E. And once E1 and E2 are embedded in the same space, you can use the Hausdorff distance to evaluate a kind of distance between the embeddings. Okay, mm-hmm. So then you minimize over like the infimum over all choices of capital E and the isometric embeddings. This gives you the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between E1 and E2. So this is the idea of this small picture. You try to embed the blue space and the red space into the same metric space capital E in such a way that, okay, the Hausdorff distance between the embeddings is as small as possible. Okay, so this Gromov-Hausdorff distance has nice properties, and the space capital K equipped with the Gromov-Hausdorff distance is a Polish space, separable and complete metric space. Okay. So now I come back to my problem about random planar maps. So I have my capital Mn uniformly distributed over p angulations with n faces. So I can look at the associated metric space V of Mn equipped with a graph distance. And you see here, I rescale the graph distance with this factor n to a negative power, eh? And I look at these as random variables with values in this Polish space capital K, and I can study the convergence in distribution. Okay. And of course, what is this rescaling factor? Of course, as you can imagine, A is chosen so that the typical diameter of a p-angulation with n faces is of order n to the power A. Okay. And it has been known for some time that the correct value of A is a quarter. Okay, so I can now state the first result about the Brennan sphere, the result of construction of the Brennan sphere, if you want. So this is just to remind you of the notation, MNP, all p-angulations and faces. I pick one at random, capital MN, vertex set, graph distance. And the theorem says that if either p equals 3 or p is even greater than or equal to 4, so if I rescale the graph distance by this factor n to the power minus a quarter, and I also have this constant Cp dependent on p, I get a convergence in distribution to a certain limiting random compact metric space, this M infinity D. And the nice thing is that the limit, as I said before, does not depend on p. I get the same limit for p angulations, for triangulation, for quadrangulations. And this is what I call the Brennan sphere or the Brennan map. Okay? So I should mention immediately that there has been many extensions of these results to more general random planar maps. In fact, here I was dealing only with the case of even values of p greater than or equal to 4, but there is a recent work of Adario Berry and Albanc, which is able to treat also odd values of p. Okay? And one can consider many different models of planar maps. Roughly speaking, each time you impose a kind of bound on the degree of faces, in the limit, you will get always this Brennan sphere. Okay. So a few properties of the Brennan sphere. It's a geodesic space, meaning that if you make any two points, they are connected by a geodesic, which may not be unique. Okay. So this is true simply because essentially, random planar maps, well, if you modify them a little bit, they are geodesic spaces. And in the limit, this property is preserved. Okay, you can prove that the Brennan sphere has dimension 4 almost surely. And it's also true that it's almost surely homeomorphic to the two sphere. So roughly speaking, it's topologically the sphere, but with a very wild, very irregular metric, so that its Hausdorff dimension is equal to 4. Okay, so to conclude this first part, I should mention that there are deep connections with the theory called the Liouville quantum gravity. I'm not going to speak about that here, but I mention it. And in fact, Jason Miller and Scott Sheffield have developed a program, written a series of papers that relate the Brennan sphere to this Liouville quantum gravity. And this gives a new construction of the Brennan sphere using also a certain random growth process they call quantum Loebner evolution. Okay. And this construction makes it possible to have additional structure on the Brennan sphere. It's conformal structure, which is in fact determined by the metric space. Okay. And I should also mention that more recently, this Miller-Sheffield construction was simplified in a paper of Gwynn and Miller. Well, I should have mentioned many other people, in fact, because this paper was a kind of conclusion of a whole series of papers of different people. What they did was constructing directly from the Gaussian free field, the Liouville quantum gravity metric, a special case of which gives you the Brennan sphere. Okay. So there are different approaches, which I'm not going to discuss, to this object. And in fact, this object is more general here because Liouville quantum gravity depends on the parameter, and there's only one particular value of the parameter corresponding to the Brennan sphere. Okay, so in the second part of the lecture, I'm going to discuss a little bit the construction of the Brennan sphere, because that's going to be important when I speak of geodesics later. So the Brennan sphere can be constructed by as a quotient space of another famous probabilistic object, which is the CRT, David Aldous Brennan continuum random tree. So I guess many of you are familiar with this object, but I will briefly recall how it can be constructed. So again, it can be viewed as a universal limit of a discrete object. But for me here, I will prefer to present it as a random R tree coded by a Brownian excursion. Okay, so to explain this coding, I just remind something very elementary, which is when you have a discrete plane tree like this one. Okay, so a plane tree means that it is rooted, there is a root here, and it is also ordered. So when you draw it, you can explore the tree from the left to the right. And so you can explore your tree by following the arrows as here on my picture. And if you look at the graph of the function that gives you the distance from the root vertex in this exploration, this is what I call the contour function. It's a way of coding the tree. And it's very easy if you know the contour function, if you know this object here, to come back to the tree simply by gluing together a certain segments of the graph of the contour function. Now, what I'm going to explain is that this construction by the contour function can be extended to continuous trees, okay? So the continuous trees I'm going to consider are the so-called R trees. So here I call them real trees. So for me, they will always be compact, but of course it can be more general. So a real tree is a compact metric space such that between any two point A and B, well, you have a unique path, meaning, well, a continuous and injective path up to reparametrization, okay? Mm-hmm. And moreover, so you have the red path here. Moreover, this red path is isometric to a line segment, okay? So you can also define the notion of a rooted real tree. You just distinguish a particular point, okay? So the idea of an R tree or real tree is that you take a connected union of line segments, like on my picture here, which is a tree in the sense that you have no loops, and you equip this union of line segments with the metric, which is simply the distance between A and B will be the length of the unique path from A to B. Okay, mm-hmm. And essentially the compact R trees can always be approximated by such finite unions of line segments. Okay, even if they can be more complicated, you can have infinitely many branching points and uncountably infinitely many leaves. So the coding of discrete trees, which I just explained on the previous slide by contour functions, also works, can be extended to real trees. And additionally, this will give you a cyclic ordering on the tree, which is important for my purpose. Okay. So here is on this slide a brief definition of the tree coded by a function. So this function g is going to play the role of the contour function I had before. So you have a function g defined on the interval 0, 1, not taking non-negative values, which is continuous and starts and ends at 0. So here is the red graph is a graph of my function g. And I introduce this notation, mg of st is the minimum of g between s and t. And then I define this dg of st, which is a kind of candidate for a distance, which is simply the sum of g of s plus g of t minus twice the minimum of g between s and t. So in my picture, it represents the sum of the lengths of these two blue segments if s and t are here, okay? So this is not really a distance, it's only a pseudo distance in the sense that you can have distinct points s and t, which are at distance zero, okay? And this occurs, in fact, in this setting here, t and t prime. This occurs when the function g takes the same value at t and at t prime and takes larger values between t and t prime, like here, okay? So what you do, you identify t and t prime if dg of dt prime is equal to zero. And you can then very easily prove that the quotient space of 0, 1 for this equivalence relation, you equip it with dg, which becomes a real distance now on the quotient space, you get a real tree. And this is what I call the tree coded by g. And this coding, in fact, gives you this cyclic ordering I was mentioning before, meaning that you can use simply the canonical projection from 0, 1 onto the quotient space. And it gives you an exploration of the tree, which is cyclic because it comes back to its starting point. One is equivalent to zero in an obvious manner. Mm. And so it's a cyclic exploration, if you want, of your tree. And that's going to be useful for me. Okay, so this was previous slide was completely deterministic, but now I take a random coding function, which is going to be a Brownian excursion with duration one. And the CRT may be defined as a random real tree, which is coded by this Brownian excursion. Okay, it's now random because I took a random coding function, I get a random object, okay? So here is a simulation of the CRT, so it's a complicated tree, but it's a binary tree in the sense that you have branching points, of course, but they can be of multiplicity three, okay? So points are of two types. If you want, you have leaves of multiplicity one, you have points of multiplicity two, and you have branching points of multiplicity three, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, so now I need something else to give you my definition of the Brownian sphere. I need to assign labels to the point of the CRT, okay? And in a random manner. So before dealing with the CRT, I'm going to consider a deterministic real tree. But you should keep in mind that later, this real tree here will be the CRT, it will also be random. Okay, so I start with a real tree with a root row. And while Brownian motion indexed by this real tree can be defined, well, it's a usual definition of Brownian motion, well, indexed by the half line, for instance, it's really the same definition. You say that it's a centered Gaussian process, which is vanishes at the root, and such that the variance of the increment between A and B, two points of the tree, is just the distance between A and B in the tree. Okay? So just to give some more intuition about this definition, I'm going to view this ZA as a label assigned to the point A of the tree. And my labels evolve like Brownian motion when I move along branches of the tree. Okay, if I want to understand what the label of A is, what I can do, I can run a Brownian motion starting from zero at the root along this line segment. And the value I get at A is the label of A, okay? The same if I want to get the value of B, except that I use the same Brownian motion until the point where the geodesics from the root to A and B become different. Okay, so now I can define the Brownian sphere. So as I told you, now I take a random tree, not a deterministic one before. So I take the CRT, TED, I defined for you before, the tree coded by the Brownian excursion. And given the CRT, I look at Brownian labels on the CRT, so Brownian motion indexed by the CRT. So you have two levels of randomness if you want, okay? So I define now this strange function, but it's not so strange. It looks a little bit like the function I used to define the coding of trees. For any two point A and B in the CRT, this D0 of AB is the sum of the labels of A and B minus twice the minimal label between A and B. So what do I mean by between A and B? It's very important here that I use this cyclic ordering. So this interval AB on the tree corresponds to the vertices when I visit when I go from A to B in this cyclic ordering of the tree, what I call here the clockwise ordering. It's the same as the cyclic ordering I was mentioning before. Mm-hmm. But of course, I can also go from B to A. It does not give me the same interval. So I take the maximum of these two minima here. Okay. So this function D0 is symmetric, obviously non-negative also. But it does not satisfy the triangle inequality. So what I do next, I take this capital D, which is a maximal symmetric function of A and B, which is bounded above by D0 and satisfies the triangle inequality. So I can define it if you want by this infimum, okay? Mm-hmm. And okay, now this is really a pseudometric on the tree. So I can play the same game as before. I identify two points, A and B, if capital D of AB is zero. One can prove this is not at all obvious that this is in fact equivalent to D0 of AB equals zero, okay? And the Brownian sphere now will be the quotient space of the tree TE for this equivalence relation equipped with the distance induced by capital T. Okay, so it looks a little bit complicated. In some sense, I already used an equivalence relation, a quotient space if you want to define the CRT, TE, and now I do another quotient space to get the Brownian sphere. I could have done both quotients in one step, but I prefer to think of it like this, in two steps. Okay, so just to explain a little bit this definition. So you start from the CRT, well-known object now. You have these Brownian labels. Each point of the CRT is assigned a certain label ZA. And what you do essentially is you are going to glue certain pairs of vertices of the CRT. You glue A and B if they have the same label, ZA equals AB. And if you can go from A to B around the tree, this cycling exploration, visiting only vertices with greater label. Okay, so maybe I should have mentioned before, does it work? This quantity here can be zero only if the three terms are equal, okay? Of this is equal to this equals this. And this means that one of these two minima is equal to the label of A and to the label of B. Okay, so maybe on the picture, this is just an illustration of what I was saying here. In red, this is interval between A and B. Here I represent the labels horizontally. All these are supposed to be Brownian curves. So the evolution of labels along the branches of the CRT. You identify A and B. If you can go from A to B, you see you get only greater labels. Okay, it's not so important. So what I'm going to use for geodesics, it's a key property of distances I will state now. So I need some notation. Capital pi will be the canonical projection from the CRT onto the Gaussian space, which is a Brownian sphere, okay? Mm-hmm. And okay, I told you I had labels on the CRT, but these labels can be defined as well on the Brownian sphere because, well, as I just mentioned before, if I glue two points, they have the same label, okay? So I can also assign these labels to the point of the Brownian sphere, okay? Now, the following fact is important. There is a particular point of the Brownian sphere which corresponds in the Gaussian space to the unique point of the CRT with minimal label. If you prefer, it's also the unique point of the Brownian sphere with minimal label, such that the distance from this particular point, which I denote here by x star, are precisely given by the labels, but I have to shift them to subtract this here the minimum label, okay? Of course, the distances have to be non-negative. So here I take the label of X minus the minimal label on the Brownian sphere, okay? So labels exactly correspond to this shift by the minimum here to distances from X star, okay? So I should also mention here for later purposes that I have two distinguished points on the Brownian sphere. Well, you have this point X star you have just defined here. And there is another one called here X0, I'm not going to use it so much, but which is corresponds to the equivalence class of the root of the CRT. And one can state in a precise sense that these two points do not play any special role in the sense that they are uniformly distributed over the Brownian sphere. In a sense, I could make more precise, but maybe I have no time to do that. Okay. And in particular, this X star, it's also true for X0, is a typical point of the Brownian sphere. Okay, now let me come now to geodesics and to begin with, I'm going to speak about geodesics from this typical point X star. And how can you construct these geodesics? So what you can do, let's take a point A here, okay. So on my picture, I took a point A, which is not a leaf of the tree. So the tree is represented in black. You know, you should think of it as a finite union of line segments, but you could have started from a leaf also. How do you, can you construct a geodesics from this point A to the point X star? Okay, I should not say from A, but from the equivalence class of A, this X equals pi of A. So what you do, better to explain it on the tree, you start from A, and you go backwards in cyclic ordering. You follow the contour if you want of the tree, but backwards in order to find points with smaller and smaller label, okay? If you do that, eventually you will arrive at the root because the root is the point, not the root. You will arrive at the point A star, this X star, because this is the point with minimal label, okay? So what you do, you define this phi A of T, which is, well, the projection on the Brownian sphere, of the last vertex B before A with label T. So label here is this tilde because I've subtracted the minimal label. So this is if you want the renormalized label, okay. Mm-hmm. And okay, so last really means that you go backwards on the tree following the contour like this. Okay. And this phi A of T, I have no time to explain it, but it's really very simple to prove, gives you a geodesic from X to X star or from X star to X, okay? Mm-hmm. So this is also something that you can see. I did not mention the discrete approximations because I didn't want to spend too much time on that, but you can do exactly the same construction of geodesics in the discrete models in quadrangulations, for instance. Okay. Mm-hmm. So in this way, you construct particular geodesics from any point of the Brillouin sphere to this particular point X star, okay? Mm-hmm. And this is what I call a simple geodesics. And in fact, one can prove, so this is not at all a trivial fact, but one can prove that all geodesics starting from X star can be obtained this way. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, here what you can notice is that if you start from a point which is not a leaf, you have several possible choices of simple geodesics. So this was the idea of my picture here. So this A was not a leaf. You can start from the right side of A here, you construct the red object, or you can start from the left side of A and you construct this object, okay? Mm-hmm. And so you construct two simple geodesics. In fact, eventually they will coalesce, I will explain that later. But you see that these points of the tree which are not leaves have the property that there are more than one geodesic to the point X star. Okay. If you start from a leaf, then you will get only one simple geodesic. The reason is that you, except at the starting point, your simple geodesics visit only leaves. You cannot play this game of choosing the side you start from, except at the initial point. Okay, so here is the main result about geodesics to a typical point. So you saw that leaves were important. So I defined this skeleton of the tree as a set as a tree minus its leaves, okay? And I also define this object scale, which is just the image of the skeleton of the tree under the canonical projection. And in fact, if you restrict the canonical projection to the skeleton of the tree, you get a homeomorphism. So this scale is a homeomorphic image of something which is a non-compact R-tree, in fact. In fact, one can prove that this scale is a small subset of the Brillouin sphere. Okay, it has dimension 2, whereas the dimension of the Brillouin sphere is 4. Okay, so this corresponds to the fact that in the CRT, most points in some sense are leaves. Okay, so the set of points which are not leaves is a small set. So why are these objects interesting? Well, you can prove that this set scale corresponds to what is called the cut locus of the Brillouin sphere relative to X star. It's a set of points where you don't have uniqueness of the geodesic to X star. Okay. And more precisely, if you start from a point that belongs to scale, you can prove that the number of distinct geodesics from this point to X star is a multiplicity of the point X in scale. Okay. And this multiplicity, this is what I mentioned before. In the CRT, you can have multiplicity at most three. So you will get at most three distinct geodesics to X star. And the last point I wanted to stress here is the fact that X star does not play any special role. You have the same results if X star is replaced by a point chosen at random in the Brillouin sphere, okay, by a typical point. Okay. This is, in fact, a kind of invariance under rerouting. Okay, this is an illustration of the result before. So you have this cut locus, which I denoted by scale. So in green, I try to represent the Brillouin sphere at infinity. And inside the Brillouin sphere, you have this this tree here, which is, well, it's a homeomorphic image of the non-compact R tree, because it's non-compact because I removed the leaves. But this this tree is dense in the green object in the Brillouin sphere. And this object, this scale, is exactly the cut locus, as I explained before. And your geodesics, if you start from any point, it will not visit scale, except at the, possibly at the starting point, but it will move around this tree until it reaches X star. Okay, it's only a naive interpretation. So something that's going to be important is that you have a confluence property of geodesics, okay? So I already mentioned it very quickly, but here is a more precise statement. Well, maybe I do not explain the corollary, which is more precise. I just say you have the following fact. If you pick any two geodesics going to this particular point X star, but it will also be true for a typical point, they have to coalesce before they hit X star. They coincide near X star, okay? So in some sense, you have only one way of leaving X star along of geodesic, okay? So why is it true? Okay, so maybe let me explain that on this picture. So here I have picked two points A and B, okay? And I remind you of the way I constructed geodesics before, okay? What I do, for instance, starting from A, I go backwards following the contour of the tree until I find points of smaller and smaller label until I reach the point with minimal label, which is here, okay? Mm-hmm. This gives you my geodesic, okay? Mm-hmm. Well, of course, I can do the same from B, get the blue curve here. But now you can see that the blue and the red one must coalesce, and you know exactly at which point they coalesce. They coalesce at this point C prime, which is last point, should say, before A, where you have a label equal to the minimal label between A and B. So if you want, okay, let me explain that. You start from B, you find vertices, points with smaller and smaller label. But at some point, you have reached the minimal label between A and B, okay? And then if you want, you have to jump over A in order to find points with smaller label, okay? And at that time, easy to see that you have to coalesce with the red geodesic here starting from A. Okay. This point here also has to be visited by the red geodesic. Okay, so I hope this is clear, but I will maybe come back to that also later. Okay, so in the last 15 minutes or so, I want to discuss geodesics between exceptional points. So these are really the recent results I wanted to talk about. And okay, so let me discuss how many geodesics you can have between points, okay? So suppose you take X and Y for two typical points in the Brillouin sphere. For instance, I did not speak about the volume measure, but there is a natural volume measure in the Brillouin sphere. You see, first the CRT is equipped with a natural Brillouin measure, which is a push forward of Lebesgue measure on 0,1 under the coding I explained to you before. And then you can also take the push forward of the volume measure on the CRT to get a volume measure on the Brillouin sphere, okay? So you take two typical points on the Brillouin sphere, there is a unique geodesic between these points, okay? In fact, you just have to use what I said before. You can take one of these two typical points, you can take it to be equal to this X star I had before. And you just use the fact that the cut locus has zero volume, in fact, which is easy to prove. But now you take only one typical point, say X called X star, and now you say that you have exceptional points Y for which you can have more than one geodesics. So this is what I explained before. You can have up to three geodesics from Y to X, okay? If X is typical, okay? This is where you get three geodesics for points Y that correspond to branching points in the CRT in my construction, okay? If X equals X star, okay? So you can have three geodesics. But now you may ask, what happens if both X and Y are exceptional? And then there is a recent paper, this recent paper I mentioned before by Jason Miller and Wei Qian, which I think improved on previous work of Angel, Kolesnik, and Miremont. They proved that you can have up to nine geodesics from Y to X if they are both exceptional, okay? And they do much more than that. They even compute the Hausdorff dimension of the set of pairs XY such that you have exactly K geodesics between X and Y, okay? So I'm not going to discuss that here. What I want to talk about geodesic stars, okay? Which is related, but not exactly the same problem. So what do I call a geodesic star? So a point X of the Brillouin sphere is called a geodesic star with n arms if it is the endpoint of n disjoint geodesics. Well, when I say disjoint, it's of course except at their endpoint. Okay, so there is a picture. You have the point X and this blue, black, orange, red path as opposed to represent geodesics. Okay, and you see that, well, they do not coalesce. They meet exactly when they arrive at X. But of course, if you have a typical point, it cannot be a geodesic star, because we saw before that any two geodesics to a typical point, they coalesce. So they cannot be disjoint. Okay. But still, there can, it's not hard to see that you can have geodesic stars. For instance, if you take an interior point of a geodesic, it is a geodesic star with two arms, obviously. So here is a theorem I want to speak about. I look at a set of all geodesic arms with n arms. Then you can compute its Hausdorff dimension. And you can show that this also holds for n equals one, in fact. You can show that the dimension of Sn is equal to 5 minus n. Okay? So I mentioned these two papers because Miller and Kian proved the upper bound, and I completed their result by proving the lower bound, in fact, on this dimension. Okay, okay, there is still a nice open problem. You see here, I do not consider n equals 5. Okay, so this result should be true also. I think Miller and Kian say it's true also for n equals 5, but they do not know, and does not know whether that S5, that of geodesic stars with five arms, is empty or not. Okay, so this is still open. Okay, so I mentioned another nice result of Miller and Kian. They proved that a set of all interior points of all geodesics has dimension one. Okay, in some sense, the set of all interior points of geodesics is a very small space set in the Brillouin sphere. Okay, so of course you can see here that the dimension of geodesic, it should not be geodesic arms, it should be geodesic stars, I'm sorry. The set of geodesic stars with two arms has dimension three, okay. So an interior point of a geodesic is a geodesic star with two arms, that's obvious, but it's definitely not a typical one. Okay, you have many, many more geodesic stars with two arms. So I'm sorry for this mistake. It's really geodesic stars, of course, with an arms. Okay, so let me briefly summarize the results on geodesics in the Brillouin sphere. This paper by Miermont in ENS already obtained the uniqueness of geodesics between two typical points. And the result, in fact, this paper by Miermont also holds in higher genus analogs of the Brillouin sphere, which I am not discussing here. Okay. Then the result I mentioned before about the geodesics to a typical point are in this paper of I wrote 10 years ago. And the notion of geodesic star was in fact introduced by Grégory Miermont in his paper proving the uniqueness of the Brillouin sphere, in fact, in 2013. And I already mentioned this paper by Angel, Kolesnik, and Miermont in 2017, which obtained first results about what they call geodesic networks. Geodesic networks correspond to the union of the geodesics connecting two points. Okay. In fact, there is a much more complete description of geodesic networks in this paper by Miller and Kian, and I said before, also the upper bound on the dimension of geodesic stars, so the lower bound here. And maybe I should also mention that there are related results in Liouville quantum gravity. In particular, Gwynne and Miller have extended the confluence property of geodesics. And this played an important role, in fact, in their proof, the very recent proof of the uniqueness of the Liouville quantum gravity metric, okay. Existence and uniqueness. Okay. And there are more recent results by Yuan Gwynne about geodesic networks also in Liouville quantum gravity. Okay. Okay. So in the last 5 or 10 minutes, I want to give you maybe an idea of the proof of this lower bound. Okay. So in fact, for proving such results, it's more convenient to deal not with the Brownian sphere I introduced before, which may be called the standard Brownian sphere, but with the free Brownian sphere. Okay, so the difference is that the free Brownian sphere has now a random volume, and it's defined now under a sigma finite measure. So if you remember the construction I gave you for the Brownian sphere, I was starting from a Brownian excursion with duration one. So essentially you do the same construction, but you start from a Brownian excursion under the Itô measure, so with a random duration. So if you're familiar with the Itô measure of Brownian excursions, it's exactly the same construction. Okay. So then you define, this is something, of course, which is usual when you study exceptional points, for instance, of Brownian motion, or for more general random processes. You want to study geodesic stars, but you define the notion of approximate, epsilon approximate geodesic star. Okay. So if epsilon is positive, you say that a point X is an epsilon approximate geodesic star. If you have n geodesics to X, you require them that they start from the boundary of the ball of radius one centered at X, and that they are disjoint, but only up to the time when they come within distance epsilon from X. Okay, so of course, the smaller epsilon is, the closer you are to a real geodesic star. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, what's going to the difference, of course, is that now you will have the volume of epsilon approximate geodesic star will typically be non-zero, and you can have estimate on the volume of epsilon approximate geodesic stars. So essentially, so I'm using this volume measure on the Brownian sphere. What you can get, first moment estimate and a second moment estimate. Okay, so this is the first moment estimate here. So you look at the expectation under n0. Okay, so n0 is an infinite measure, so expectation is not quite proper, but let's say. Expectation under n0 of the volume of epsilon approximate geodesic stars with n arms. Okay. And you can prove that this is bounded below by a constant times epsilon to the power n minus one. Okay. Maybe I will give you a hint of the proof of this estimate. This is not too difficult. Okay. What is more delicate is the second moment estimate. Okay. So for second moment estimate, I could consider the square of the volume. But I want more. So instead of the square, I look at this double integral where I also put here the distance between X and Y to this negative power. Okay. So you can prove that this expectation is bounded above now by a constant times epsilon to the power twice n minus one. Okay. Mm-hmm. And okay. Once you have these two estimates, well, there's still some work to do, in fact, but you have more or less standard techniques. You consider the volume measure restricted to the set of epsilon approximate geodesic stars. You normalize it suitably. You can prove that when epsilon goes to zero, you can extract a subsequence, a convergent subsequence. And this limiting measure will be supported now on geodesic stars. Not only epsilon approximate, but really on geodesic stars. Okay. Mm-hmm. And the second estimate here tells you that the limiting measure, okay, I repeat, the limiting measure is obtained as a limit of the volume measure restricted to approximate geodesic stars, suitably normalized. Okay. And you can prove that this limiting measure satisfies the kind of condition you find in the classical Frostmann lemma. Okay. So you know that the support of the measure then has a dimension here, which is greater than this power, which appears here, phi minus m, okay? So this gives you the lower bound, and I wrote m here instead of n. It should be n here, I'm sorry, okay? This m should be n. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's not completely standard, but it relies on well-known techniques, okay? So maybe now I will explain to you how we can get such an estimate here. Okay. And for this, I need a tool, and this tool is the notion of a hull. Okay. So I first introduce the ball of radius r centered at the point x of the Brillouin sphere, this is br of x. And then if I have a second point y, I can define what I call the hull of radius r centered at x relative to y, which is obtained, okay, maybe I can write down the definition, by saying that it's going to be larger than the ball. It is obtained by adding to the ball all connected components of its complement, except the one containing y. Okay, so this is the meaning of this definition here. Maybe I can do a picture here. So I have this is supposed to be a cactus representation of the Brillouin sphere. So the vertical coordinate corresponds to the distance from the point x, which is at the bottom here, okay? And I assume that y is at distance greater than r from x. I forgot to say that before, but you have to assume this, okay? D of xy greater than r. And of course, then what is the ball br of x? It's just a set of points in my cactus which are below level r, set all these points below, okay? If you look at the complement of the ball, you have, of course, you may have several components. In fact, you have infinitely many such components. And what you do to get the hull, you add all these components to the ball, except for this one, for the one containing y. So the hull is now the blue set here on this picture. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I hope it's more or less clear. Something you can make sense also of the size of the boundary of the hull. So the boundary of the hull is here. You can define a kind of boundary hull, boundary size. But maybe I don't explain that more. Okay. Now, what happens is that you can have a Fourier representation of a hull. Okay. So I'm going to consider two typical points. So I can take this x0 and x star, which I introduced before. I can take the corresponding hull, where I defined if the distance between x star and x0 is greater than r. And you can again have a representation of the hull, which is very similar to the construction of the Brownian sphere, except that you now have to consider a Poisson process of real trees, okay, which are essentially scaled copies of the Brownian of the CRT. So, here is perhaps a more precise definition of this Poisson forest. And you view all these trees as planted uniformly over the interval 0 u, where u is the size of the boundary of the hull. Okay, so you have the line segment 0 u here, and all your trees which are there, it's a Poisson collection. Okay, so you have this forest of trees, and now you can recover the hull with its intrinsic distance. It will not be the original distance of the Brillouin sphere, but the intrinsic distance of the hull from this labeled forest by exactly the same construction as the Brillouin sphere before. Okay. And the label shifted by, okay. So you have to condition the minimal label on this forest to be equal to minus r. And if you shift all labels by plus r, you again get an interpretation of these labels as distances from a particular point x star, which I again denoted by x star, which is a point with minimal label, okay? And maybe, okay. So what you have to remember is that essentially the same construction as before. I have all these more or less copies of the CRT, scaled copies of the CRT indexed with Brownian labels. You play the same game as before and same identification as in the construction of the Brownian sphere. And you get an object which is a hull of radius r. And now, because again, you have this interpretation of labels as distances from this point x star, which is a point with minimal label. I put it here in my picture at the bottom. Mm-hmm. You can again define the geodesics to this point x star in the same way as before. So going backward or forward, in my picture it was more forward, in the forest until you find points with smaller and smaller labels, okay? And so you have the same way of constructing geodesics to this x star. And Now, when will X star be an epsilon approximate geodesic star with M arms? This will be the case, essentially, if you have M trees in the forest, which have a label smaller than minus R plus epsilon. So remember that there is a point here with label minus R, the point with minimal label, but the other trees are just conditioned in some sense to have label, minimal label greater than minus R, okay? So, but you want M minus one other trees, essentially, to have a minimal label smaller than minus R plus epsilon, okay? And it's not hard to see that the probability of this event is about epsilon to the power M minus one, okay? Okay, so this is how you get now the first moment estimate, in fact. Okay. So what happened for, this is my last slide for the two-point estimate. This is sometimes more delicate and you need several ingredients. Essentially, this theorem here is a key ingredient of the proof. It tells you that, roughly speaking, if you take two typical points, so I take here the x0 and x star, if you condition on the event that they are distance greater than 2r, and you consider the hulls of radius r centered at x star relative to x0, and the same hull when x0 and x star are interchanged, so the blue one and the green one here, essentially you get independent objects conditionally on the boundary sizes. Okay, and you can describe again the distribution of these objects as before in terms of certain labeled forest of labeled trees. Okay, so if you want, it's a kind of special Markov property. You get the independence of disjoint parts of the Brownian sphere. And this is really what you need to get the second moment estimate. Okay, I think I should stop now. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jean-François, in particular for a talk which contained both something for the experts and for the non-experts. So I'd like to invite people to ask questions. So either please unmute yourselves and just shout out or write in the chat if you prefer. I don't know if Sergei Pirogov wants to ask a question that came up in the chat earlier. Sergei, if you would like to do so, please feel free. I don't know if he's still here, actually. Perhaps I can ask a question. Do you have a conjecture for what's going on in the case n equals 5?
Oh. Well, my conjecture was that the set is empty, but Jason Miller told me he believes it is not empty. So I'm not so sure now.
Did he have a reason?
Well, it's a very bad reason. So you know, I've studied exceptional points of Brownian motions, for instance, cone points of Brownian motion. And in the critical value, in the critical case, it turned out that the set was always empty. But here, of course, it's a very different situation. So you cannot infer anything from what happens for Brownian motion. Okay? And really, I don't know. I've not thought so much about that. Well, the reason I have not thought so much about that is that as you see in my paper, I prove the lower bound. So it's techniques that apply to get the existence, that would apply to get the existence of the geodesic arms. But if they do not exist, well, it's harder for me to handle the upper bounds, in fact. Mm-hmm. Okay. But I don't know. I don't know, maybe Jason or Wei are working on that now. I don't think so, because I had contact with them, but.
Something for the future in any case. any other questions from the audience?
I have one, or maybe even two. In this case where you've got exceptional points that have nine geodesics between them, mm-hmm. you know what they look like at the end. Is it sort of, you know, is it two, three stars connected? How do these, you know, there are some star points involved somehow, but.
Yeah.
It's very hard to imagine what that might look like.
Okay, I have to think about it. In fact, yeah, if you have two, three stars that are connected by these geodesics, of course you would get, I'm saying something wrong. Well, okay, I'm not, maybe I prefer to refer you to the paper by Miller and Kian. So what they do, they analyze the topology of geodesic networks. So they pick two points, for 2 points x and y, they look at all geodesics between x and y. Mm-hmm. And what happens is that these geodesics can share a common part first, and then they can branch. And I'm going to say something wrong. No, you cannot have that. You can have a 3-star in the beginning, and then two of these geodesics are going to coalesce. Then the third one is going to coalesce a little later. And then at the other end of the network, you have the same situation, I think, also. And so if you want, you have 3 choices at the beginning, and they all these coalesce. Mm-hmm. And then you have again 3 choices. Okay, so in the end, you have 9 choices. I think that's what they have in their paper.
Okay, so there's some segment in the middle that's the same, but all 9 of them go through. Yeah.
Okay. I think so, yeah. Uh-huh. If I remember well, okay. You should check in the paper.
And so another question. So the set of points which are interiors of geodesics is really, really small, just one dimensional, which is somehow very hard to understand, because even you take 2 points, the geodesic between them is already one-dimensional, but now you vary the endpoints arbitrarily, and somehow it's not larger in dimension. And those the points along there are 2 stars, and are they? They're not typically stars. Are they not 3 stars, or usually, or do you have any idea about that?
No, that's a good point. I should have mentioned that this result about the dimension of interior points, mm-hmm. it was already conjectured in the paper by Angel, Kolesnik, and Mirmont, but it was proved by Miller and Kian. Mm-hmm. And you can construct, that's quite easy, in fact. You can construct a geodesic 3-star with the properties that two of the geodesics, that's the point is an interior point of a geodesic obtained by taking two arms, you see. Maybe I'm not explaining it well. What I mean is that you can have an interior point of a geodesic from which starts a disjoint geodesic. See what I see? You have another disjoint one. You see, you can have it's a very special 3-star. It's a 3-star such that if you concatenate 2 of the arms, you get a geodesic.
Right.
So you can have that, and that's easy to construct, in fact. Uh-huh. But again, it's not a typical 3-star. So such points, I get you have only countably many or something like that.
Okay, so they're not. They're not typical interior points of geodesics either. Then, in that case, okay, that answers.
No, that's also a special point. No, I agree. The result about interior points is quite surprising. Yeah, but it seems to be true.
Thank you.